ladies and gentlemen, as I was preparing the talk, it turned out that another title will reflect the nature of this talk much better. So today I will be presenting to you a phenomenological light on light by Suhrawardi, which is former transcendental riches and riches of experience. In the study of religion, light has become an allegorical cliché, which is taken for granted. Phenomenological examinations of such cliché reveal their fallacies, and in this process, phenomenology's own postulates can be also clarified. To demonstrate how this may take place in the phenomenology of visuality, I will review the illuminationist philosophy of Shihab al-Din Suhrawardi, who created his philosophy of illumination in the 12th century northwestern Iran, near modern Azerbaijan, and in Anatolia. I intend to show that in the case of the perception of light, the visual reference acquires a metaphysical importance which hasn't been yet embraced by phenomenological philosophy. To begin, let us briefly recall the phenomenological thesis of perception. In the premise of perception, Merleau-Ponty states, the perceived thing is paradoxical. It exists only in so far as someone can perceive it. Merleau-Ponty goes on to say that perception always carries a paradox of immanence and transcendence. On one hand, the perceived object cannot be foreign to him who perceives, but perception always contains something more than what is actually given. First of all, it is the absence which backs up the presence. Extending perception as such to perception of the world, Merleau-Ponty further treats Kant's quote, if a world is to be possible, end quote. The possibility of the world is in the presence of others and in our shared participation in the world. This, of course, is a reference to chapter 5 of Husserl's Cartesian Meditations, and this brings in the concept of constitution. Husserl's constitutive analysis turns towards life and its metaphysics in his Phenomenology of Consciousness of the Eternal Time, and especially in the analysis concerning passive and active synthesis, when he realizes that perception as such requires its own condition of possibility. Then he uncovers the horizon of pure seeing. Further, in the development of phenomenological movement, Henri argued that the given, the manifestation itself, shows us that Husserl's pure seeing itself needs grounding in more foundational horizons. So this is Sailor on Henri. The fundamental mode of appearing, namely the self-appearing of appearing, cannot have an intentional structure. It must be non-intentional, and since intentionality is tied to visibility in the general sense of perception or representation, invisible. So Henri finds this horizon of possibility in this invisible phenomenological materiality. But the phrase which follows, quote, the phenomenalization of phenomenality, end quote, implies, per se, that it is the visual reference that gives us the world. We routinely use sentences such as consciousness and its process of constitution is better interpreted as recognition, quoting from Maran, or the body is the most complicated logic that I will ever see because I cannot fully see it, quoting from Costello. But we quote this without considering what those statements really mean. Then there emerges a strange situation in which pure seeing is either grounded on itself or has an origin in something essentially different, that is, in the invisible. This strangeness suggests a missing a priori and a need to find the horizon which accounts for visibility per se. Even if seeing is something we do, the conditional visibility doesn't pertain to the activity of the ego, but is clearly given passively. With regard to Kant's quote, if a world is to be possible, end quote, the world has to contain the possibility of such possibility or visibility within itself. As I will show for Suhrawardi, it is only because we ourselves enjoy being possible within the world that we can claim the transcendental as our own. According to him, light requires no absence for its presence, nor does the world horizon, which is given to us by light, require presence of the other or even our own presence. It's light which makes things visible and therefore immanent to us. However, the immanence of light is possible only because its essence is in us, as well as in the visibility of the universe. One of the advantages of taking Suhrawardi seriously is that he pushes our understanding beyond the usual boundaries. Partner specifically insists on introducing more empirical elements in transcendental argument by which we respond to criticism, because philosophical reflection and reasoning depend on assumption that might be described as empirical, that is, that the mind has no access to external things or properties apart from that provided by the senses. But secularization has committed us to limiting perception, and thereby to limited epoche. For example, we standardly lump together senses which have very different ontological definitions, such as visuality and touch, and we maintain that intentional relationship always involves sharp object subject-object distinctions, etc. As Husserl says in philosophy as rigorous science, in close examination of transcendental problem, all kinds of riddles surface. So this is quoted from Husserl. How experience as consciousness can give an object or hid it, how experiences can reciprocally legitimate to correct one another, and not only cancel one another out subjectively or reinforce one another subjectively. How a play of experiential logic and consciousness is to mean something objectively valid, something valid for physical things existing in and of themselves. Why, so to speak, the playing rules of consciousness are not irrelevant for physical things. How natural science is to be comprehensible in every respect and for everyone, insofar as it intends at each step to posit and know nature existing in itself over against the subjective class of consciousness, etc. So these are riddles. It can be argued that if we still do not have definitive answers to those questions, this is because we derive our understanding of experience from secularized experience. As in the case of visual perception, such understanding is partial and leaves out a whole spectrum of unexamined possibilities. That said, I have no doubt that this idea, apart from concrete examples, may evoke lots of criticism. And therefore, I will let Suhrawardi's argument unfold before such criticism will be voiced. So here is light as the ground of philosophy in Suhrawardi's illuminationism. Suhrawardi starts his illuminationist philosophy with the following statement. Anything in existence that requires no definition or explanation is evident. Since there is nothing more evident than light, there is nothing less in need of definition. This statement is both resonant with and different from Merleau-Ponty's view. Merleau-Ponty indicates that the philosophical evidence proper consists in something that can be to be perceived. For this appearance of something, both the presence and the absence are needed. By contrast, Suhrawardi believes that the perception of visual light signifies not only pure presence, not just immanence, but absolute evidentiality. He later contrasts light with the things hidden. However, the modes of existence in light and the things hidden are different. They are not ontologically equal opposites and are not dialectically interdependent. For Suhrawardi, the world is possible due to the evidentiary rigor or intensity of its appearance. Such appearance depends on the evidentiary character of light. Being aware of the frequent readings of the term light as a metaphor, Suhrawardi clarifies his stance. A thing is either light and luminosity in its own reality, or is not light and luminosity in its own reality. the meaning of light and luminosity are the same here, for I do not use this in a metaphorical way, as when light is used to mean that which is evident to the mind, though even such usages do, in the end, derive from this light. Against the idea that our grasp of the world and ourselves is only partial, Suhrawardi suggests that the appearance of the world depends on the principle of full availability, evidentiality. Light is such a principle because there is no ambiguity in how light is given. Suhrawardi points to the fact that within our knowledge there exists an indivisible, immutable certainty. This certainty is neither associable with the Cartesian cogito, nor it is associable with Husserl's idea of adequacy. Importantly, Suhrawardi doesn't include subject-object divisions in his concept of light, not until he uses specific reduction, which I will explain later. So Suhrawardi treats evidence as a principle of self-evidence which has a special relationship with things which depend on this evidence. This is the standpoint from which he unfolds his transcendental argument. He says, if you wish to have a rule regarding light, let it be that light is that which is evident in its own reality and by essence makes another evident. It is thus more evident in itself than anything to whose reality being evident is superadded. Suhrawardi begins constructing his argument from a concretely visual reference, not in the least because 90% of information the brain absorbs is visual, and visual information is processed 60,000 times faster than the text. People remember only 20% of what they read and 10% of what they hear, but they retain 80% of what they see. The visual cortex occupies an astonishing 30-40, and according to some sources, 50% of cerebral cortex total surface area. However, in classical phenomenological analysis, this massive input of visuality is masked by the general analysis of perception. This appears to be a historically constituted situation. It is well known that both visuality and light were central to the early Greek understanding of the world. Things were there and this as phenomena, that is, lighticals, given to us by means of light. Later, there is a shift to hyletic reference in Aristotle's work. Since then, hyletic reference becomes more and more connected with the development of reasoning and natural science, and the reference to direct intuition and light remains largely closed within Neoplatonism and transitions into religious discourses. So this is the example of treatment of light in Neoplatonism. This is from Philo, and Philo says, we see two things, the sensible form and the light which makes it visible. But we should not know that we saw the light unless we saw the form. So the intelligence sees being by light given by the one. It must turn away from all objects and contemplate this light. But the analogy of the eye will carry still further. For the eye has light in itself, that light that you see when you squeeze your eyelids. The intelligence must concentrate itself on this inner light. Mystical introspection further takes the form of seeing oneself, seeing into oneself. But philosophy for many centuries takes a break from such concerns of seeing oneself until the focus on subjectivity is reintroduced in philosophy by Descartes. In its treatment of visuality, phenomenology very much absorbed the hyletic reference, that is, treating the visual world as sensory perception of colors and shapes. In such approach, there is an implicit ontology of localized bodies, which leaves out the question of why and how these bodies appear to us as primarily visually given bodies. But Suhrawardi doesn't share with us this sedimentation of sense around the hyletic reference. Europe lost its classical Greek heritage in the fire of Alexandrian library, circa 300 Common Era, and gained it back only later by the time of the Renaissance, by a Syriac, Persian, and Arabic translation of Greek texts, which were passed on by the Muslims. Neoplatonic philosophers of the school of Athens sought a refuge in Persia from Christian persecutions. Consequently, in Islamic philosophy, Greek philosophical influences were absorbed without an intermediary. Suhrawardi showed specific interest in early Greek philosophy, and in particular in Plenary, who was interested in light. Suhrawardi also develops a criticism of peripatetics and reinterprets Aristotle as a proponent of knowledge by presence, that is, within visual reference. He also has access to Indian and Iranian philosophy with its own extensive reference to light. And of course, as a Muslim philosopher, he has access to ideas regarding visuality and light in the Quran, the Bible, and possibly in the Gospel of John. So the references to light in the sources which were available to Suhrawardi can be summarized as follows. Light as visual light as a part of mental imagery appearing in introspection, such as in absorption, a semi-allegorical use of the term light, that is God as light, and a metaphysical interpretation of self-awareness as light. However, to paraphrase Husserl's comment on Kant, Suhrawardi is quote, the trailblazer, not the perfecter, end quote. He streams light into transcendental argument of his own. This argument closes the gap in the phenomenological interpretations of visuality. So here is explication of light according to Suhrawardi. As we may already infer from our brief overview of the historical backgrounds, Suhrawardi's transcendental argument grows out of a particular system of experience. In the system, there is no stress on subject-object opposition. Rather, Suhrawardi contrasts the existential mode of the mind and of the things in the world. This distinction doesn't involve the idea of mental intentionality directed at objects. For Suhrawardi, all things, including the mind and non-mind, belong to the world horizon. The soul, that is consciousness, is also organically included within the world. Thereby, he treats the self, others, and light by means of the same logical propositional reasoning and with the same set of categories. His position might have been interpreted as naive realism, but in fact, his position is much closer to the metaphysical neutrality than the position of post-Cartesian naive realists, such as, for example, John Searle. Here is a quote from Searle. Consciousness has a first person or subjective ontology, and so it cannot be reduced to anything than this that has third person or objective ontology. If you try to reduce or eliminate one in favor of the other, you leave something out. Biological brains have a remarkable biological capacity to produce experiences, and these experiences only exist when they are felt by some human or animal agent. You can't reduce this first person subjective experience to third person phenomena for the same reason that you can't reduce third person phenomena to subjective experiences. End quote. While acknowledging the special status of consciousness, post-Cartesian naive realism also creates an unsurpassable ontological gap between the brain and the rest of the natural world, and by the same token, between consciousness and the real objects of its knowledge. By contrast, Suhrawardi doesn't refer to the natural visible light as an object of consciousness. Instead, he examines the modes of givenness with regard to their evidential impact. His sharpest opposition is between the Zahir and the Batin. Zahir can be translated as exterior, evident, apparent, obvious, that is, fully exposed to explicated, and Batin as hidden, veiled, interior, or invisible. Therefore, to examine light, one needs to consider it in its own class of essences, that is, separate light per se from the light in the veiled things it illumines. Suhrawardi says, light is divided into light that is a state of something else, the accidental light, and light that is not a state of something else, the normal jarat, lightly rare or denuded light. The full self-givenness of light is contrasted with dusky substances. The hiddenness of dusky substances is not a result of limitations imposed by the bodily logic of perception, and it is not a result of reduction that the senses impose on the objective world. The hiddenness is their nature. They form barriers to light and become evident by light. In themselves, they hardly exist. Their only existence is in serving as barriers to light. That is, their existence is in the other. By contrast, light is simple, indivisible, self-evident, self-luminous, and self-contingent. Suhrawardi says, that which gives them dusky substances, their lights, must be something other than the barriers and dusky substances in themselves. In philosophy as a rigorous science, Husserl states, quote, every psychological judgment contains the existential positing of physical nature, whether explicitly or not, end quote. Suhrawardi purifies existential positions of their highly connotations, reifying the visual aspect of them. Thereby, light's mode of existence is discovered as a condition of possibility for all appearances. Different from real objects, perception of light doesn't require vibrations, and it is not hidden behind the face. Its givenness is not restricted by our environment. The logical environment goes like this. If I see the world by the logic of my body, and the logic of the body is that I can never fully see, what follows is that I cannot ever fully see the world. But the perception of light is always full and complete. What follows is that if I can fully perceive the light by which the world is given to me, my knowledge of the world is not caught up in the subject-object divisions or an environment which I somehow have to transcend. On the contrary, since the world is by light, and I see by light, the world is visually imminent to me. Likewise, if myself is in the world, and since myself is evident to me, I must be partaking in the full imminence of light. But do we perceive pure light? In fact, we can and we do. In the retina, there are special rod cells which perceive just white light. The differentiation between rod cells and other kinds of cells, cones, goes back to a span of a couple hundred years, million years in evolutionary history when our ancestors were nocturnal. Color perceiving cones also perceive white light when the stimulus they receive are in the equilibrium. As physicists say, without light there would be no sight. So here is the picture of retina, rod cells are in green. The cones are in purple, so rod cells perceive just light, white light. Some esoteric techniques, for example, Gurdjieff, even train this perception of pure light, focusing on the degrees of colorless luminosity. Another phenomenon related to perception of pure light is the light of absorption, categorized as jhanas in Buddhism, or as the shifts of light in the Orthodox Christian philokalia or Chinese treatise, Secrets of the Golden Flower, etc. However, pure light is not an object of sensory perception, and we do not perceive color as an object, of course. When, back to physics, when photons are hitting the biomolecules of the retina, they convert into an electrical signal passed on to the brain, and the signal becomes a visual condition of possibility for other aspects of seeing. What exactly happens in this process is not clear. More studies suggest there are structural changes in photon-sensitive proteins. Other theories suggest that there can be a spatial nano-antenna structure in which light interacts with the spaces between individual molecular receptors, and the interaction is not based on photons as particles, but on photons as waves. The millions of these individual retinal structures function as devices in the near field of the light wave on sub-micron dimensions, and each retinal device translates the absorbed nature of light into an electron particle, therefore affecting a quantized interaction at each site, etc. Tanonian Koch, who is a Nobel Prize winner in molecular biology, suggests that seeing should be considered as a simple physical system, and that consciousness evolves not as a result of the natural selection, but as a byproduct of such system. And just as I was preparing this address, Michael Bidball published a paper in which he suggests framing a new ontology. Such ontology would be different from that of localized bodies, that is highlight reference, and would correspond to the symbolic system of standard quantum mechanics, which is much more visual. In the case of perception of light, there is certainly a new representation involved, new synthesis of signals of different kind. Rather, there is a situation in which a purely physical, very simple system becomes evident to us and serves as a condition of possibility for other persons to become evident. We cannot say at what level the physical processes become consciousness, but we do see a linear isomorphic continuity between the external physical process and the internal biological process. As for the theory of relativity, the speed of light, which is light per se, light doesn't exist as something static, determines temporal sequencing and causality of our universe. Under special theory of relativity, if something travels faster than the speed of light, it goes backwards in time. Such a proposition would interfere with the basic rule that cause precedes effect, called causality. Since there is a direct transformation of electromagnetic signals photon into the condition of possibility for all appearances inside the human body, we can suggest the following conclusion. The same process which determines all causality in the universe at the same time plugs the human being into the very organizing principle of causality. The process not only directly translates into vision, but also into consciousness. We can either think of the human being as a part of this physical system, or we can think of the physical system as extending into the human being and becoming consciousness. But in any event, the point is that the human being is not opposed to the universe as a conscious subject vis-a-vis inanimate object, but rather as a conscious subject is intertwined with the universe on a very foundational level. So here comes the transcendental unity according to Suhrawardi. Suhrawardi continues his explication of pure light by stating, since you know that any light can be pointed to is an accidental light, then if there is a pure light, it cannot be pointed to, nor located in the body, nor have spatial dimensions. Among the givens, the only thing which fits the set of conditions is pure awareness. The negation or reduction will go in the direction of pure subjectivity. Another possibility is to interpret such reduction as abstraction, but it doesn't hold in the context of the rest of Suhrawardi's analysis. According to contemporary debates, awareness is the property of the self. Suhrawardi at this point is not yet talking about the self, but reduction in 112 in this verse will be a reversal of the perspectival horizontality of outgoing consciousness towards the irreducible backdrop of all experiences, that is, myself. Empirically, this backdrop can have a variety of relationships with phenomenal consciousness, such as in discussions of minus, minus, for minus, etc. It also can have ecological and non-ecological formats. In religious philosophies, the situation was noted and discussed. There are various maps of how the pure subjectivity, end quote, can be configured, such as the maps of Samadhi in Yoga and Vedanta, or the states of divine immediacy in Sufism, or the Ripa states in Buddhism, or the treatises related to ego dissolution in Vedanta, etc. But Suhrawardi's primary interest is not in finding the answer to the question, who am I? Reduction supports his main agenda, which is uncovering the absolute indubitable givenness, a pure evident, which is a conditional possibility for all other givens. Suhrawardi's reduction is denoted by the term charada, to strip off the coverings, to make bare. Later, he introduces the term veils as the object of charada. Consequently, the result of reduction is called by Suhrawardi light made bare, or denuded light, that is, normal charada, as something, normal charada, and sometimes normal charada, pure denuded light. Suhrawardi points to the universal horizon of seeing, which would be just seeing without a vector of seeing or seeing something. Against the Cartesian cogito, Suhrawardi insists that this essence of evidence is not a thought. Thought for Suhrawardi will be a component of the mind, a mental essence, and therefore divisible. But since more pure light awareness as a horizon of seeing is in every thought, Suhrawardi will further provide extensive analysis of the relationships incurred by such mixing of light awareness with the mental objects. To better understand Suhrawardi's reduction, we can turn to Husserl's philosophy as a rigorous science in which Husserl states, if we bring color intuitively to full clarity, to full givenness for ourselves, then what is given is an essence. And if likewise we bring to givenness for ourselves in pure seeing, perhaps looking from perception to perception, what perception? Perception in itself. that which is identical in arbitrarily many flowing singular perceptions is, then we have grasped the essence perception in seeing. So as we know, Husserl's reduction is always some kind of internal doing. It's not a mental abstraction, but it's a modification of internal consciousness. Even though this modification just simply explicates the modes which are already in that consciousness. But here Husserl is suggesting an experiment which we, I don't think, can perform. Yeah, because Martin is already signaling on me. So I'll move on and try to wrap it up. Okay, so how much time do I have?
Zero.
Oh, wait a second. Isn't it that it's still 12?
No, it's 2 minutes to come up.
Okay, so I have voted to 12.
Yeah, but it's until 12 for both of you.
Both of us?
Yeah.
Oh my God, I'm so sorry. I thought it's an hour. Okay, so the rest of this talk, it's an hour long talk. I'm very sorry, Martin. Yeah. Okay. I prepared the explication of the whole Suhrawardi argument, where I have to apologize with despair and just wrap it up and say that he establishes the visual unity which completely corresponds with what is given to us by physics. And I'm very sorry, I feel embarrassed, and I retreat.
Thank you so much.